Now we are moving on to the second work stream, data and analytics, which, as I mentioned to you, is run by Gabriel Eichler, who's here in the room with us today. And we are so fortunate that Alice Park, senior writer at Time Magazine, has agreed to moderate this panel. She's super smart on the data and analytics space, so we're so happy to have her. The way we decided to do this one was to first have someone that has the data, right? So one group that actually has a major data set. So that is the MMRF, and what you heard a little bit about before is our $40 to $50 million data set that we started on the genomic side, what that offers us. And then secondly, to bring in Colin Hill from GNS, who does the data analytics around our Compass data set and can talk quite wisely about, you know, why you need additional data sets coming in and the challenges of sometimes getting those data sets. And then we have Lee Newcomer, who retired just 3 weeks ago from United Healthcare and is loving life. And so he's going to talk about, you know, you may actually think you know exactly what to do based off the data, and it may or may not get covered by the payer, and it may or may not become practiced by the health system. So it's going to be a great panel. I'll turn it over to all four of them. Thank you very much for being here.
Thank you, Kathy. Well, I've come to call this in my own mind as the number crunchers panel, but I promise you that that it won't be as dry as the term data and analytics sound, because I think we have here a very exciting case study, really, of how to make data. We've been talking a lot this morning about collecting data, the kinds of data we can get, and how important it is. But really where the rubber meets the road is interpreting that data and making it work for patients and turning it into treatments for patients, ways of improving their survival, and that's what we're here to talk about. So if you go on the MMRF website, there's a vision statement that talks about one day having every multiple myeloma patient able to look on their smartphone, access the world's state of knowledge about the disease, and the available treatments, and ultimately find the right treatments for them so that they're not doing a wild goose chase, they're not going from doctor to doctor, they're not having, you know, months, weeks, or months even of kind of uncertainty and angst in what do I do, trying to make a hard decision. And the Compass database, which MMRF really pioneered and has really become known for now, is, I think, the key to making that a reality. So, Paul, I want to start with you. If you could sort of bring us up to date on this database, which includes 1,100 patients, and really is pioneering in the sense that it's collecting data over a long period of time over patients so that we can really learn about what treatments people decided to take, decisions. So sort of, I think of it as each decision tree. You know, you can kind of say, Mrs. X did this, Mrs. Y did that, and here's how, you know, how things turned out for them and how you can learn from that so that, you know, patients 10 years down the road can say, yes, this is something that really I can follow and it might help me. So let's just bring us up to speed on where Compass is now.
Okay, and thank you, Alice, and thank you, everyone. And I'll just talk, just want to start though with a story that sets up Compass. And this is, as many people here know, multiple myeloma, cancer of the bone marrow, there's still no cure for this disease. A good friend of mine recently, I was talking to him, he'd been through a transplant, he'd been in a durable remission for about 12 years, but his disease came back. The multiple myeloma became active. So he's like, what do I do? So he went to one major medical center, and they told him and said, well, you know what, it's just starting, it's just kind of getting going. Let's just observe. He went to another major medical center, and what they said is, they said, you know, we better start treating you with certain drugs, with these new drugs. Went to another major medical center and they said, you know what? You should go for a transplant right now. Right now. This is the same guy. He went to three different places, names. If I gave you the names, you would know them. And it gets to, Robert, what you know, you kind of were looking at, saying, well, what should I do? How do I know what to do? And the vision that we have, Alice, exactly at the MMRF is, let's say we have perfect information about every single multiple myeloma patient in the world. And now we can start analyzing that data and start drawing some of the things, Bill, you were talking about making predictions based on patterns and be able to say, hey, this is what you should do based on the evidence that's statistically significant, that's data driven. So that's kind of the big vision where we're going. In terms of Compass, though, to ask your direct question, that was a study that was started a number of years ago that's following 1,154 multiple myeloma patients, all who are newly diagnosed. And they get their genetics, their genomic testing done right up front, and then they're followed longitudinally for years and years. And so what that does is that starts this whole process of being able to say, if you are diagnosed with this particular disease and you follow a certain pattern, how do other patients that look like you, as Kathy said earlier, that have your particular subtype, because it's not just one disease, it's many, what is the best course of action? So Compass now, we're still following patients. There were 1,154 that started in the study. Unfortunately, we've had several hundred that have passed away given the nature of this disease, but we're following them all longitudinally and trying to build and continue to build on what is the single largest genomic data set in all cancer. So that's kind of to tee up kind of what we're trying to do and really the data that we're building and how important data is.
And I want to just follow up on that with, as you were collecting this data, what sort of obstacles did you come up against in order to make that vision of saying, all right, you know, in theory, yes, if we have all the data and we have, you know, we know what every patient with multiple myeloma has decided to do, what treatments they took, and we know what happened to them over a period of years. What were the challenges that you came up with as you then tried to translate that for people and say, okay, if I have a friend who's recently diagnosed with multiple myeloma, you know, go to the Compass database. Yeah. Is that something they can do?
Well, the Compass database, it is out in the public domain. So we put in the genomic data commons. So it is available to researchers, if you would. But the first obstacle is one that Ann Quinn-Young talked about. It was just aggregating the data. I mean, just trying to get, you know, this number of patients. It's a number of different countries all over the world. So you try to aggregate the data. But data just sits there. Data is data. If you have the greatest amount of data, but what we talk about, Alice, is that we don't need just data. You need information. And then out of that information is what are the insights that will improve the treatment for the patient. So that's where, on one hand, you're looking at the scientists, but then you start looking at others. You know, some like Colin at Gene Network Sciences and firms that do artificial intelligence, machine learning, because there's just so much data there. How do we get information? And then out of that information, how do we drive insights? And that really is when we start needing to go to third parties to do some of the analysis. And then also look, as Lee will talk about, other data sets. Is there ways we can continue to build that? Because at 1154, given all the subtypes, that really is not statistically significant yet. So we can get some ideas about it, but it's not something you can drive clinical decisions yet until you amass enough data. And that's why when we talk about this idea of the different silos, one of the terms that we've coined at the MMRF is the cancer archipelago. With this archipelago of all these different islands of data that don't have bridges built between them, and that's one of the things we need to do so that the folks in artificial intelligence, machine learning, and others really can start driving clinical decisions that will improve patient care.
Now, Colin, I want to ask you about when you're looking at a data set like Compass, and it comes from patients. So it again, as Paul was just saying, it may come from places where they collect the samples differently, or you know, they're looking at different parameters and different measures. Are there ways that AI or machine learning can standardize that and find a way to make sense of that data?
The answer is yes, but let's separate standardizing from making sense of it, because this is a patient registry. It's been collected in a way such that it's really near clinical grade, which means we can, even though it's an observational study, it means that we can use it to discover what treatments are working for what patients and to discover the subpopulations. So that's a big deal. And I really, you know, thank you, Kathy, for the vision here, because in some ways I feel like, you know, GNS has been living in a parallel universe to MMRF for for nearly 20 years, right? And it's great that we've been able to come together here because we couldn't do what we do without the data. And this is longitudinal, multi-omic, with outcomes. And so in terms of now making sense of the data, right? How are we using AI and machine learning to make sense of the data? And, you know, we've now been at this for 18 years. And so the platforms that leverage supercomputing and decades of Moore's law are able to now turn the data, transform the data into models of the actual patient disease progression and response to treatment. And I think one key thing to take away from this is that we actually have had some successes together. And it's not just any kind of machine learning. It's machine learning that can not so much try to find patterns in the data, but use the data to reconstruct models of the patient so we can now simulate interventions like stem cell transplant patient by patient. This was done over the past year to actually discover a marker to answer a key question for patients, which is, does stem cell transplant work for me or not work for me? It's part of standard of care, but we know there's a lot of patients who get no benefit, some patients that do. On average, there's 12 months of progression-free survival. Using 645 patients of the COMPASS study data and the GNS REFS technology, we were able to make models that we could simulate stem cell transplant on or off, and what was revealed in less than 3 months was the key marker, the check one gene expression level, as the marker to determine whether someone's gonna get 20 months of progression-free survival or close to zero. In December, this was validated by Dana-Farber and presented at the big conference in blood cancers. And so this is a great example of what happens when this kind of consortium comes together to produce this, probably the richest data set of its kind in oncology, and where you now combine that with the far advances in machine learning and AI, in less than 3 months, a person trained in electrical engineering, he's not a stem cell transplant expert, he's not an expert in multiple myeloma, was able to use this technology to drive this discovery that was now validated. This is really amazing. And now we're at a stage where it's time for prospective, true prospective validation of this. And I think the big takeaway is, where can this go? If this was done in 3 months from 645 patients worth of data, what happens when we now have 6,000 patients worth of data and we have Amazon supercomputers, you know, five times as fast as they are today? That world is coming, and so that's why I'm very optimistic for how the ecosystem is going to now be able to take these discoveries and start to clinically validate them, put them into clinical practice, and then eventually start to pay for them in the real world.
Yeah, and I want to jump to Lee. I want to come back to that point. But Lee, I want your perspective here on this. Let's just take this biomarker as an example.
Sure.
What would it take then? It's been validated by Dana-Farber, reputable cancer institution. What would it take for UnitedHealthcare to say, this is great. This is something that we need. This will help us decide, you know, which patients would most benefit from this, and therefore, you know, we'll support it.
Right. Colin and I have known each other for 10 years, and so he calls me, and I felt like I'd just been given the stone tablets. Here I am. this is great data. This is great information. If we had a drug that could add 20 months of life and compared to zero, it would be on the headlines everywhere.
And more importantly, know which patients
would
get those 20 months, right?
So the question that came up in my mind was, it wasn't convincing me, I was there. I called the head of our scientific advisory board for transplant technology, and he immediately came to, well, where's the controlled trial? Where's the clinical trial? So I went back through the methodology. Remember Colin talking about building models and then retesting that, and so that showed in COMPASS that the check one made a difference, and then they revalidated that on an entirely different data set. This is good science, but it's not the clinical science that physicians in the field use and understand. So they're suspicious of it, and they're concerned about it. And making a decision about a bone marrow transplant is a major life decision. So they're uncomfortable. And the long and the short of it is, as I talk to physicians in the field, then basically until we had some kind of clinical trial, randomizing between yes and no, they were not willing to move forward. And I think that's a barrier we're going to have to figure out how to overcome, because the science, in my mind, is good. Now, there is a piece of good news to this. If you have that kind of difference, it won't take a very large trial, and it will be done very quickly to sort that out. You don't need thousands of patients. You probably need maybe 100 if you do the stats. That's good news. But I'd like to move even one step further. When you've done this kind of work, why can't we make the decision right now? Now, expanding that, going to my database, where I'm not going to have as complete information as Compass by any stretch of the imagination, we might find 6,000-7,000 more patients, but it's still not going to be trusted data because of our locked-in mindset about clinical trials. And we've got to overcome that. We will.
And that raises an important question then about when we're talking about data and analytics. And you're talking about sort of new models of using AI and machine learning to kind of build these models that, you know, a human would take much longer or might not be able to come up with. Is that the new model for the future? I mean, will we have to, when you're talking about kind of changing the thinking on this, you know, are we going to be able to convince the medical community that a randomized controlled trial, which should remain the gold standard, but could it be supplemented by, could it be informed by, you know, models that were created by a machine or by AI? And you know, how do we think about sort of, again, accelerating the whole process so we don't have to sit there and wait for someone to invest in the trial, set up the trial, enroll patients in the trial?
So I think we are at a tipping point of where the data has become sufficiently rich and machine learning is crossing over from just a finding of patterns. Patterns are fine for recommendation engines or online advertising. If you like this movie, what other movies do you like? Okay. Here in medicine, we need causality, right? And what was the point of clinical trials in the first place? It was to establish causality, randomized controlled trials for causality. Machine learning has now gotten to the point of being able to at least probabilistically start to establish causal relationships from observational data. And this is huge. And there's already been regulatory changes that allow some of this new information to get used. So the passage of 21st century cures is now allowing label expansion on drugs from observational data. That's a big step. That happened 18 months ago. So I think we are at a different place now. And medicine is different. It's not just the world of A/B testing like they do in consumer internet. We're now able to start to get at that causality, and I think that's going to enable more of a learning healthcare system where we don't have to wait for 5 years to run a trial and determine and answer one question. Why can't we be answering these questions from the actual practice of medicine? And this is where payers and providers have a direct role.
And those probabilities are 80-90% range, right?
That's right.
So in clinical medicine, we're making decisions every day with probabilities of 60%, 50%, and we think that's okay.
And let's remember that randomized control trials too, you know, don't always establish causality. I mean, I can tell you from speaking to umpteen scientists, the first thing they always tell me as the irresponsible journalist is, this is an association, it's a correlation, where it's not causality. So, you know, if that's the case, you know, how are we going to start looking at some of the models, some of the conclusions that we come up with when we do these kind of data analytics against, you know, what we might get with a randomized controlled trial, and how do, you know, places like United Healthcare make that comparison and come to a conclusion about, you know, when it's enough, you know, when it's sufficient to take action?
I think you're going to see a transition to people with large data sets beginning to use that kind of technology, AI with probabilistic causation, as a decision-making focus. Mm. I mean, we have a pragmatic problem, and I think Kathy brought it up in her very first remarks. To answer the questions we want to answer today, we'd have to have thousands, if not tens of thousands of trials, and that just pragmatically is not possible. Right. So rather than just stagnate, we need to learn other ways to get to that answer. I would look across the ocean over the UK, where they are now basically profiling every single cancer patient, combining that with the EHRs, and they will have a treasure trove of data for someone like GNS to come into and start exploring what are those causative agents that we ought to look at, or what things should we begin changing. We don't have anything that unified in the U.S., and that's, I'm sure, what the Accelerator is about, as I'm sitting here listening to this morning. The more we can put data together on a national basis, the better off we are. I mean, it's great that Dana-Farber is doing a coalition with some other academic centers, but that's such a teeny little group. We could expand that substantially.
Well, and I, just to add to that, too, I think one of the things that when you have the data, then you can start saying, what are the questions that we need to get answered? And I know one of the things that we've been doing at the MMRF, we have one of our programs is something we call the Answer Fund. And it's what we did is we crowdsource questions from patients. We went across the board and said, hey, what is on your mind? What's on the mind of the patients? And one of the big questions is this whole idea of maintenance therapy. Should I be on maintenance therapy or not? And again, like the story I told earlier to start, there are doctors that after your transplant, they just put you automatically on maintenance therapy. You're on the maintenance therapy, you say, well, sometimes that's used as a frontline treatment, and those are not just innocuous drugs. There's side effects and other things. So should you or should you not be? Which subset of patients should or shouldn't be on that? So that's one of the things I know we're working with Gabe and doing some things with this Answer Fund to say what are the questions that we need to ask? That's one. And also a second one we're working on is in regard to who are the high-risk patients? Because again, it's somewhere in the data, but you just don't know. Some patients, as I mentioned earlier about Compass, lose their battle with this disease in the first 3 years. 25% of the patients roughly die in the first 3 years from diagnosis. Then there's others that are super responders that are out 20 years out. And why? Who are they? Can we figure it out up front so that in terms of how we treat them is going to be different? But right now, it's just kind of, well, here's the standard of care, and let's see how it goes. So I think one of the things that really becomes critical to this is just what you were both talking about, building a large structured data sets, and then asking which questions, determining which questions we should ask. Just one other comment on that, and I'd be interested to hear everyone else's opinion on this, but the other piece is around incentives. Because one of the things we felt we needed to do at the MMRF is we have put out I'll call it a grant, but really answer this question. We've put millions of dollars behind this because we need to incent people to go to the data and get the information and then drive these insights. And that's not something that if it's just sitting there, it's going to happen. So how do you motivate that to start getting some of the questions you were talking about answered and then be able to change clinical behavior? So those are some of the things that I think are critical in the data area. What are the questions? What are the incentives? How do we move it forward?
Yeah, and to go back to Clifton's analogy of, you know, the looking for the keys under the lamppost, yeah. How does, Colin, I'd like your perspective on how does the sort of shift in doing what Paul was just describing and saying, all right, let's you know, find out what the questions are. Where is the critical need? You know, do I need a transplant or not? Should I be on three drugs or two drugs? You know, these kinds of questions that obviously have a lot of clinical importance. How do we shift from the traditional model of research where the researcher finds a target, an interesting target, and yep. puts all their attention on it, you know, and could spend an entire career looking at it. And there's nothing wrong with that. But if we're talking about, again, you know, increasing the pace of how we come to right. answers that will make clinical differences, right. How does that change the way you collect the data, you analyze the data, the type of data you're looking for? Yes.
So I think the biomedical industry has pretended for many decades that these systems, while they're complex, that they're not that complex, that empirically you can discover each pathway, each target, and somehow make sense of diseases and drive treatments and cures. It's just not that simple. Like at the base of human disease are complex genetic and protein networks that determine whether a cell is going to be cancerous or not, or whether it's going to respond to this or that treatment. And when you're talking about 30,000 genes and all of their gene products and their interactions where they're turning each other on and off, this kind of complexity can only be tamed by large data, multi-layer data, and these advances in AI and machine learning. If we want to do things in a truly hypothesis-free way and not look under the street lamp, this is the only way forward. It doesn't matter how smart a given researcher is. There's just too many pieces interacting in too complex of ways for us to just do this hypothesis by hypothesis. And so I think, you know, in the context of what Paul was describing, we now are getting to the point of sufficiently dense data sets and machines that can answer these questions for us, that can now start to reverse engineer and say, well, what are the underlying mechanisms that could explain whether a patient's going to respond to maintenance therapy or not? And I think that's the big transition where we're going from is hypothesis-driven research, which is one by one by one. And by that path, it's going to take us another 1,000 years to cure a lot of these diseases. Or we can just start with the data and say, what are the hypotheses, all the hypotheses that are consistent with this data?
And let the data do the talking, really.
Let the data do the talking. It's the only way. I mean, humans stop at roughly 7-8 variables at a time. Right. If we can, like even the smartest of us, Frank McCormick, a big cancer researcher, great guy, discovered the RAS-MAP kinase gene, but then they were thwarted by a feedback loop that stopped that particular drug from working. I mean, that's going to be repeated 100 times.
Yeah. We're going to do that a lot. The incentive portion, I think it's a vision I'm struggling to get my former employer to understand as well. But this same data could begin parsing out all the waste.
Right, exactly.
We do so many things that are that make good theoretical sense and don't work, but they all take resources. And so one of the things that I would love to do with our observational data, and I think it's planned for 2019, is we democratize it and put it out there on the web in a format that consumers can see and use. There's no reason, we've looked at the top 5 regimens for lung cancer. 2 of them are lousy. They're 4 times more expensive. They don't get the same results as the other 3. They do worse and they cost more money. Why are we doing those anymore? That's a tremendous waste of resources.
But you would get pushback from the physician community.
Well, probably the manufacturers of the drugs as well.
Of course, yeah.
But the data's the data. And if it doesn't work, we have either 2 questions asked. Was it used on the wrong patients? The FDA label would say no. Or is there something unique about those patients that we don't yet understand? And we go right back to what Colin's doing.
Right.
In the short run, we could also say, we've got 3 that work. Let's get rid of those 2 and move on to a more important issue. But either way, it could be used to free up resources in a very positive way for the system.
Yeah, and just one comment, too, when you look at the data. I think there's other aspects of it, too, that one of the things about Compass was very driven around genomics. And now, one of the things Kathy was talking about earlier is just the importance of your immune system. And so now you start getting to what data should we be collecting in the future? Because it's one thing, you know, Colin, you can only analyze what you have. So what are the things we should be collecting? How should we go about it? And then how do we get that into some sort of a structured format? So whether it's at Orion or a Compass or others, that we can start sharing that in a reasonable kind of way and then start applying that. So that's one of the things I think we all struggle with. I know there was a point made earlier about, do you just get it unstructured and then sort of after the fact sort it out? I'm not sure that's the way to go. From what we've seen, we feel that we need to put some guideposts at least in the ground, establish what are the standards. I mean, I've used this example before. Before we built the Transcontinental Railroad, we had to say, what's the gauge? So what's the gauge on this? And let's go ahead and then we can start building the railroad and moving ahead. So I think that there's the data we have now, adding the data sets, and then what is it we're going to need in the future, and try to at least look over the horizon a little bit so that we're able to put that together so we can answer some of these key questions.
I think that's an important point to remember, especially given our previous panel about the direct to patient, and if we're able to now enroll patients that way, you know, directly from them getting their EHRs, we're going to need to have some kind of, you know, navigators to help us get the kind of data that Colin can do something with, right?
Can we chug along with the railroad? I think the track gauge in this problem is, how is that test being done? Because we know from welfare data that basically if you send the same tissue sample off to three labs, you will often get two or three different reports. I worry less about the other standardization. In fact, I was resonating with that comment because we don't know whether it's going to be steam or diesel or electric or anything else, but we do know they have to have that common gauge. So there's a balance there. I worry about if we try and structure everything, we will have created a lamppost.
Yeah. And that's a fair comment. And I know in Compass, that was one of the things, one of the first questions you were asking about, you know, in terms of collecting samples. They all were analyzed at the same place in the same way with the systems, the processes, and procedures to do that for exactly that point. Now, you can't do that nationally or internationally, but somehow or another, making sure that it is comparable data, and I think that's a very fair point.
We could have lab standards, though, that everybody adheres to.
Yeah.
I know we could go on and on, but I want to open it up to a few quick questions in the last less than a minute. So there, let's start there.
Hi. So about 10 minutes ago, Kathy asked me to tell my story. and so I said, absolutely not. I'm going to do that. But in the spirit of like playing ball, I'm going to do so. So, you know, my story was mostly about, you know, theoretical physics, which I studied to PhD level, and then Wall Street. And on Wall Street, I was one of the early adopters of machine learning. Mm. And, you know, we were in a very similar space to the one you guys are describing, where the conventional approach was a human-driven hypothesis. And it's quite a shift to go to a machine-friendly hypothesis, which, you know, for the benefit of everyone here, a machine-friendly hypothesis can look very, very complicated. It can be very rich. It can explore a lot of cross terms, a lot of interactions, very weak interactions, and build a very complicated model. Now, on Wall Street, I was one of the first people to get into this space, and I formed a hedge fund with Glenn Dubin, who's sitting over there, and he's the founder of the hedge fund, and I'm one of the early partners in it, and you know, we've been very successful with that. And then, you know, the pivot in my story, and the reason Kathy asked me to say this, is because 2 years ago I was diagnosed with a very rare and pretty benign form of cutaneous T-cell lymphoma. Mm. So my prognosis is very good, to the extent that, you know, I'm quite likely to die of something completely unrelated. Mm-hmm. But what that did is get me interested in this space. And, you know, I'm pretty sure that's why Kathy asked me to speak up. And, you know, look, I think the approaches that we've applied successfully, you know, on Wall Street, you know, Wall Street's an early adopter of a lot of sophisticated statistical technologies. I think that these problems, it's going to be different. It's going to look slightly different. But, you know, they're eminent. I'm incredibly optimistic. And, you know, the pivot in my life was receiving this diagnosis. And now I'm incredibly interested in if we can apply these technologies to medical research problems as well. So hopefully that does the trick, Kathy.
Thank you. Fantastic.
Well, for sure. You know, getting data is incredibly difficult, you know, in the space. I mean, there's an enormous number of soluble problems that shouldn't be complicated, but are pretty complicated, we've discovered quite quickly.
Yeah.
Okay, and I'm afraid we're out of time, so hopefully your question can be answered by the panelists in the rest of the afternoon. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Lee Collins.
Yeah. Thanks for doing that.
Thanks.
Alice, thank you.